Hello, Craig. How's it going, mate?
I'm all right. Are you, Ben?
Yeah, thanks for coming on the podcast.
No worries. Thanks for having me.
Hey, so I don't really know much about you. I know you're a podcaster and you're involved with music and, I don't know, social media and stuff. Well, give us the summary.
All right. So currently, I write for an online radio station called MCR Live, which is a Manchester-based radio station. It's really weird. I've just found out, literally just found out that they're closing down as a radio station. It's kind of changing. They're going to be changing over to some other kind of like a podcast platform, but they've been going for the last couple of years. And they kind of review live music, or have been reviewing live music and new music that comes out.
I suppose the definition of a radio station has become a little bit ambiguous nowadays, hasn't it? Because, like,
Very ambiguous, yeah. It's completely changed.
I mean, it's really shifted over to podcast now, isn't it? I mean, like, when you say radio station, do you mean they're being beamed out over the conventional airwaves?
Yeah, so well, they're on DAB, or they have been on DAB, but they're a website-based radio station. So they're hosted on a website, but you can get them on DAB as well. So you can get them on sort of your normal radio or in your car or whatever. And there's an app that you could get as well.
So they're kind of in that in-between world between old-fashioned radio and podcast. They're sort of live but online kind of thing.
Yeah, so they're not a terrestrial radio station like, Heat or, Radio One, obviously, for example. They're a web-hosted radio station. But it's something's happening, something's shifting, the poles are shifting, or something, the tectonic plates are shifting of music, and it's all becoming about podcasts, everything. I genuinely think as well that even social media is going to become, is going to play second fiddle to podcasts. It's all going to be about podcasts.
That's interesting. You said that on the message. So, what do you mean exactly?
I think it's going to be a new, the, it's an old platform, relatively, podcast really, isn't it? As long as we've had iPods, we've had podcasts. But it's like this last year, it's just a flame has been lit and everybody seems to know about podcasts. And, I had a Tyler the other day doing some tiles in the bathroom and he had this podcast on. He was laughing his socks off about this film podcast. And I just thought, it's becoming so much more popular now,
Yeah, there's a lot of people when I speak to people in conversation and they listen to Joe Rogan and they listen to Jordan Peterson and like even older people of an older generation, it surprises me sometimes,
Well, I just think it's definitely going to be taking over. And it's interesting that this, like I say, so I've been writing for MCR Live, and MC, which is this, like we say, on this online radio station. But what they're going to be changing, so they're not disappearing, they're going to be changing to something else. I'm not quite sure what it is, but it's based around podcasts. And I had a pull to do my podcast back to, sort of based on writing about these bands and these musicians for MCR Live. And it's definitely going that way. I mean, even watching your podcast, I don't watch television. I don't know about you, but I don't tend to watch that much terrestrial TV. I'd rather go online and either watch or listen to
Do you know what?
podcasts.
Like, if when I'm in the car, like sometimes if I just put on the radio, I can't believe how dumbed down like the ordinary radio and ordinary TV is. It's so
Awful.
it's like bubble gum for your mind. I can't believe people watch it. Like when you're used to listening to intellectual stuff online, because that's the thing. You can listen to a podcast like there's a very specific topic like psychology or whatever you're into, and it's quite a niche topic, isn't it? And there's experts and stuff. And then when you listen just to the bullshit on the normal TV and radio
Normal TV.
is miserable, isn't it?
Well, it's interesting because you see the party line being told. You hear the same repeated. So, an example at the minute is knife crime. Knife crime. Knife crime. And Brexit, obviously, Brexit. Everyone's talking about Brexit. But you hear a thing. I don't know how it starts, but there's a thread or a slogan or a catchphrase or a topic or something that's brought up. And it's passed, and the same sentence is repeated over and over and over again until I hear my mum saying it, because she watches normal TV, she watches the adverts and the Coronation Street. And I just seem to, it's interesting that you say bubble gum, because that's exactly what it is. It's like bubble gum, it's like it loses its flavor after only a couple of seconds of listening to it for me. I watch something that's just on normal TV, and I think, this is doing what they all do. I don't know what it is that they're all doing, but they all do this crap, this shit, what you're peddling. And I just think you can get much better much more interesting sources of sort of knowledge online, and that seems to be
It
the
does.
way forward, I think.
It does work in terms of like mass hypnosis, because most people absorb their view of the world just from, you know,
What they've seen on telly.
the headlines and the news pieces they've heard. Most people don't actually listen to the, like, original, like, for example, with any controversial, let's say Trump, right? There's like not one in 100 people actually listens to the words that came out of his mouth. What they do is repeat what they've been told that he said, you know.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, it's like you mentioned Jordan Peterson before. Jordan Peterson is a bit of a guilty pleasure of mine because I think that I love everything that I love everything that he says. And the reason I say he's a guilty pleasure is because I know that he gets associated with some kind of, I don't know. It seems to be at the minute there's this very extreme sort of politeness in society that's coming from normal TV that you don't get with things like podcasts and YouTube videos, and you tend to see the actual real world when you so Jordan Peterson talks about this. I think he goes on about this like left, extreme left sort of university campus mentality where everything that you say to anybody is wrong. You're going to offend somebody saying something somewhere. But you listen to podcasts of all sorts of different types of people, and you get that's the real world because that's the real people's opinions. Even if you don't agree with it, I watched like you was talking about Joe Rogan. I listened to some tripe on Joe Rogan. He had somebody on there recently, and I thought, you're talking a lot of bollocks. But I want to hear that person talking that bollocks. I don't want it to be censored like it is on normal television. I want to hear it so that I can at least be challenged by it, you know?
Hey, another quick, just some shifting topic slightly. You know, the
Yeah.
radio station you're just talking about. In terms of monetization, I'm always curious how people monetize. Like, do they sell advertising? How do they do it?
This is why they've. So the one that I write for MCR Live, you mean? Yeah. This I think this is why they've changing the sort of idiom of the platform. I think this is why it's coming to an end because I don't think they could successfully monetize it, to be honest. So I think the way that they were doing it, I think they had funding to start it up initially, and I think that's run its course, and that's what's done it. But for my podcast, I know that I've already. I mean, I've not even been that long doing it, and I'm already sort of thinking like, how could I? You know, it's costing me this. It's costing me time. It's costing me money. How can I kind of monetize it a little bit? And I don't think there's an easy, straightforward solution to do it. I think you've got to be able to do a few things. I think you've got to spin a few plates.
Yeah, I think so. That, in my opinion, I mean, I'm just about to start doing advertising online, but I've always sold products and stuff for a long time, so I'm pretty up to speed on online marketing. I know a little bit more than most people do, and from my point of view, you got to attack it from many angles. If you've got something to promote and sell, in other words, something on the back end, like
Yeah.
whether it's merchandise or whether it's like, whatever, you know, maybe it's a course, maybe it's a seminar, maybe it's a book, you know, whatever. That's really the best way of monetizing. That's where you're going to really cash in. I mean, I haven't sold advertising before. I'm going to give it a go, and
My sort of idea was because for my podcast, it's obviously based around music, and my end sort of goal was once I've got it up to a certain amount of listeners to then use, you know, like merchandise and stuff like that. Or this is something I've done before as well, which I've organized events. So I was thinking, you know, put on music events and then kind of sell tickets for
Yeah,
music events for people to come out and have a gig, you know.
that's a good idea, 'cause when you combine community, like real life events, with sort of online reach, that's a very powerful combination then, isn't it? 'Cause like
Yeah, I've always found that with other things I've done in the past.
a
When you
sort of
combine the two, it connects, doesn't it? Something connects with people in the brain. It's like a double hit, like, oh, I've seen that online and now it's in real life. Wow. It kind of does reconnect a bit.
and I you know, people are hungry to sort of come out, you know, get off their phone and come out and meet real people in the real world as
In
well, aren't
the
they? So,
real world.
you know, any opportunity, like if it was a showcase where, because you're reviewing musicians and stuff, let's say you did a showcase and you just had like three different acts, and you know, and you could have a multiple approach. You could have merchandise for sale. You could have the ticket sale. You know,
Yeah, it's
you could
like a
be,
little CD store
you
sort of
could be.
thing set up.
You could be paid to review stuff as well, potentially, you know, presuming you build up enough influence online. You know, musicians or labels might even pay you.
Oh, that'd be nice. That'd be nice. I'd prefer it if it was from labels, Because the thing is about musicians, especially aspiring musicians, is they're all skint from my experience. But definitely from if I can get you know if I get some work from labels doing stuff like that, that'd be awesome.
I mean, nowadays, what is a label? I mean, what does a label do? I mean, I used to be a musician, but I was just a guitarist in bands. I was never signed or anything, so I don't really know the industry. I know gigs and I know live music, but I don't know the music industry as
Are you from
such.
Bristol? Is there, you're from Bristol, aren't you? Well, it's massive down there, isn't it, in Bristol? You've got a huge music scene in Bristol.
But what does a like
A
nowadays, what does
label.
a label do?
A label. So, well, it definitely lost its way for a while, but I think there's been a rekindling of what a label is just very recently since the start of this year. But I do know what you mean. So, obviously, I think we both know what an old-fashioned label was it a record label was they would go out, find talent, and then market that talent and then sell records of that band or artist or whatever, which in the olden days, up until the digital sort of revolution, was physical products, wasn't it? Vinyl tapes, CDs. So, and then obviously we've had the boom of streaming downloads, iTunes, Spotify, and stuff like that. So it kind of killed the label. And what happened was you had a flurry of people that were self-produced, self-distributing artists, such as Ed Sheeran, big example. Ed Sheeran's got distribution deals, but he never needed to have a record deal. He did a song about it that "You Need Me, Man, I Don't Need You." That's about him not needing his record labels because he can do it himself. He doesn't need it. But now what you've got is a kind of comeback of physical. People are bored of not being able to touch the music, and I think that what's going to happen is a bit like how podcasts are going to replace social media. I think that physical music is going to come back to replace streaming music.
Do you mean, what do you mean, like CDs, or do you mean live
I think
performance?
vinyl. I think there's going to be a big
Really?
recurrence of vinyl. Yeah, I don't think it's going to overtake digital music. I think we're going to have digital music now until some new technology comes and replaces it, obviously. I don't think they're going to all go back to having vinyl. But yeah, you're going to see a lot more talk of
That's
vinyl. So an example would be, so the guy that discovered Oasis, called Alan McGee, and his record label was Creation Records, very famous record label. He's just sort of come back in the music scene with his a new record label called Creation 23, and he's signing loads of young bands, like kind of indie bands, but he's only selling their vinyl. You
Really?
can't get the music on Spotify,
Oh,
iTunes, and all that. You can
interesting.
only get it on vinyl.
I mean, that's a good novelty approach, isn't it? I mean, I.
Very. That's the word, novelty. We're going to go into the age of novelty, of bespoke, of it. We've gone that far digital. I think it's going to come back the other way for a bit.
Interesting. I can see that a little
As a
bit.
mix, you know, I don't think it's going to be extreme. I don't think we're going to go back into all having record players and
I
ditching
mean,
our modems.
yeah, I can see that. Well, from my point of view, right, what I find is I'm always looking for an opportunity to go out to a real event, like I'd said already, you know, because it's so easy just to disappear down the screen. And I'm not against smartphones, I'm not against social media. I think they're great tools, but if you get out of balance where you're just spending a bit too much time online and not enough time in real life, you know, I can see that there's a need for that, you know, for real life stuff.
Yeah,
So,
definitely.
you know, I can see that a bit of novelty, like you can only hear it live or you can only hear it on vinyl and you've got to go somewhere to hear it. I can see that would kind of tick a box for me in a way, you know?
But like I say, I don't think it's in any way going to replace digital music. I think it will be a novelty, and I think that, you know, it'll come out on vinyl. Everybody will buy it on vinyl that's into that band or whatever. And at some point, it will come out on you know, the digital streaming platforms, because we're not going to get rid of that. That's not going to go anywhere. I wouldn't want it to. I love that it's gone digital, but I also do want a sense of, you know, physical music to come back into reality, I think. And it's happening.
I was thinking of putting on like a entertainment night and have a variety like music, stand-up comedy, poetry, maybe some performance, like I don't know, maybe some circus skills or something, like a
Awesome.
variety night. What do you think of that?
That sounds so good. Yeah, that sounds really, really good. I think that because I used to do a night called Grizzly. I used to run a studio. called White Bear Studios, and it was an already set up studio that I, because I do marketing as well. I did a little bit of marketing, and I managed the studio for a bit. And then off the back of that, when I left, I started this kind of promotion company called Grizzly, and we used to do. It was just an events company essentially, but I tried to do that. I tried to implement more than just music. So when you turn up, it isn't just, oh, well, there's the band over there and there's the bar. You know, we had like an art installation, and they're doing this more in Manchester as well, where they have art installations as well as the music on, and there might be some kind of mime artist walking around or a magician somewhere or something, you know, so it's a bit more 3D, a bit more tactile.
I like the sound of that. So what, tell us more about that then, Grizzly. What did you?
That's yeah, it was like a it was a promotion company really, so I called it Grizzly because I was. What I did is I ran the studio called White Bear Studios. It still exists. It's in Manchester, and I managed it for a best part of a year and a half. And to bring bands in, I built a roster of, you know, like a roster of artists that I could promote and put gigs on together for. And that was it basically. But I wanted to just make it a little bit more interesting. So we had a gig in a factory. There was a place called Factory Number One. It's in Chorley. So we had a gig in there, and then there was a place called Bootleggers, which was like an old Prohibition era themed pub, and we did a night called Prohibition in there. I just tried to do different elements to the gigs as opposed to it just being a band on a stage,
Right. So
you know.
you've done many different things within the music industry then.
I've had a good go, yeah. I've had a good crack at it over the years.
How big was that venue? Like,
Grizzly, well, the events thing wasn't that big, but that venue that I'm talking about there, that's still going, that, and it's quite a interesting little venue in Chorley. That, like, it's literally a working factory that they've, like, half of it they've sectioned off as like a bar come nightclub type thing
oh, I
that they
see.
rent
So
out.
they've turned it into a venue.
They've turned part of it, of the actual factory, into a venue. I think they manufacture beer bottles, so
Right.
there's like tanks, you know, there's like barrels everywhere. It's mad.
So why do you stop doing that then?
I stopped doing that because the God's honest truth was I didn't find the amount of people coming to the gigs was sort of balancing the books. Unless you can get the right venues in the middle of Manchester, you know, there's already a scene sort of carved out. So like Bristol is a good example. You know, there's a really good carved out music scene in Bristol. So if I went to Bristol and I put on events there, I'd be kind of guaranteeing more of a scene. But for where I was at the time, it was like I was trying to pull people in from places like Chorley and Wigan and small towns because of where I was at the time. So the studio then ended up moving to Manchester anyway. So I mean, that was a kind of a sign of the time, of what was happening at the time in that area.
What's the best way to promote an event nowadays? Like, would you run Facebook ads? Would you do flyer in? What would you do?
You've got to do everything. It's the same as what you said before about having, you know, how do you monetize something and having a holistic approach. Have you heard of a group called the Lancashire Hot Pots?
No.
They were really famous, sort of cheesy, a Radio One. They did a song called Chippy Tea, and they were like a niche, really weird, obscure little band about being a Lancastrian. Anyway, they were like a gimmick band in the late 90s, early 2000s, and they had like a number one hit. And their main guy is a guy called Sheldon, who's a good friend of mine, and they still tour this band as like a novelty band. They do like Glastonbury and stuff, but it's like a joke band, you know, like a satirical sort of thing. Anyway, his main thing, Sheldon, the lead singer, his main thing is music marketing and how to market events and what the best thing is to do. And he was basically saying that you need at least 6 months. So when I was talking to him, he said, you need at least 6 months for any, if you're putting on a serious event where you want a lot of people to turn up to this thing, you need to give yourself a lot of time. So you need at least 6 months, and you need to be in everything. So you need to be working on your social media, so all the platforms that you can. You need to get into the newspapers. You need to get onto the local radio stations, like the community radio stations, and then doing things like this, like podcasts and you know, blog sites and guest blogs and stuff like that. And you need to tick all of them. Because people go everywhere, don't they? People aren't just on one thing. They don't just read the newspaper.
How big an event was he promoting when he's talking about that strategy? Because that's a lot of time and energy to put in. So I can imagine if it's a large event and there's going to be a large payoff, it's worth it. But, you know, if you're doing like a small event in a pub function room or something, like that amount of time, is it going to be worth it?
I still wouldn't, from my experience, I wouldn't now ever put on an event unless I had. So one of two things, it would either be an event that I would have a 3 month gap in between each event, at least 3 month gap, if it was going to be a regular thing, even if it was just in a pub and I expected 50 people to come. And the reason for that is because if it's a, you know, people have lives, and although you might have the same committed people coming to the same regular event, if you're hosting it every couple of months, you're not always going to get the same amount of people. You're just not, because life happens.
Yeah.
So I want a guarantee, because I have to pay the bands, and I want to make me 20, 30 quid, whatever I'm making myself for my own spending money for doing the gig or whatever it is. You want a guarantee that you get some money for doing it. So you need that amount of time to be able to promote it properly, even if it is a small event. Unless, and here's the flip side of it, unless, this is just from my experience, but unless it's something that's already got some kind of culture attached to it. So if it's like, so if my podcast, my music podcast, really took off and it was like thousands of people were listening to it, and then I did a monthly gig, it's already got some kind of, do you know what I mean? It's already got some kind of attention, some flow, some traffic going towards it, some attention towards it that I could guarantee pulling people in with.
See, what would have to happen to get to the next level kind of money, the sort of thing where you're making sort of, you know, $5,000 or something? What size event? Like, what capacity?
For an event?
Yeah.
Oh, you're talking like the O2 or something. You're talking like O2 Apollo and, you know, all them.
What capacity is that?
Thousands. Thousands. Because for everything that's involved in putting on an event, so let's say you put on an event at, what's the biggest arena that you've got in Bristol?
The Colston Hall, I'm trying to think. Yeah, we actually don't have an arena in Bristol. Well, there's a football stadium that holds about 20,000.
In Manchester, it's probably the MEN.
Okay.
Right? So the MEN in Manchester, I don't know how many people that holds. It's a few thousand. Hmm. So if you're big enough to put on an event in that place, that's where you'd make a few thousand pounds for the night. That's profit for the band, sort of thing. But you'd have to fill it out completely. We just live in a different time of music, where I think that's what everyone's trying to figure out. How do you monetize this? How do you make the most money out of an event? How do you guarantee that you're going to get the most sales out of the record? Do you sell t-shirts? Do you sell this? What ticket sales? What's the price and stuff for the tickets? And nobody knows anymore. It's so crazy how everything's completely changed.
See, if you're just making pocket money from it, I mean, it's fair enough if you enjoy it and it's fun and that's fine.
If you want a living out of it, you have to be able to monetize it, don't you?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's not worth going through the effort just to make 50 quid, is it, on stuff like that?
See, my dad had a record. This is many moons ago. He had a record label, and it wasn't that many moons ago. It was an online record label, so it was about, let's say, 10 years ago. And you just, it's the same, it's become this way, it's, people will pay for money, but people will pay for music, but it's what music they pay for, they're paying through it, it's through the same old terrestrial sort of media channels. So like, artists get paid if it gets played on Radio 1 quite a lot through the PRS, if it goes on television, you get quite a decent share. If your music gets a million streams on Spotify, you don't get hardly anything. You get like 20 quid. So everything's kind of gone in a really weird way, where bands, to make money, have to do absolutely all sorts. Endorsement deals and sponsorship deals and things like that. So, for example, I think, have you heard of Nina Nesbitt?
No.
She's a singer. She's like an up-and-coming singer from Scotland.
Okay.
And, you know, she'll do like a deal with... what are they called? What's that? The clothing company called? I can't remember the code now, but like a clothing company. And you go on Instagram and you see she's done some kind of video with this clothing company. A bit of her song plays on the video. You see her in these clothes and she'll get a couple of grand for it. She'll make more money doing that than she'll make from selling the music.
Yeah.
I guarantee it.
Unfortunately, Everything is subject to the basic laws of economic supply and demand. There's an abundance of art, whether it's music or other forms of art, and because there's an abundance, it just ain't worth much. I know artists and musicians perhaps don't like to hear that or don't
Oh
like to
no,
accept that,
but it's the
or
truth.
it is the truth. It ain't worth anything, is the reality. And whoever's adding extra value, they stand out. There's the few that are gonna prosper and do really well, but the 95% of the volume of music is just not gonna sort of achieve anything financially, is it?
Well, it's going back to the same point of everything sort of switching to podcasts. For me, it's the same. It's the same thread, which is, I just see. I don't know if this is a bit extreme, but I see like a future of desktop publishers. I see a future of self-published people. The idea of the celebrity is going to die, I think. Not necessarily die, but I think the idea of what a celebrity is, or what a famous successful person is, or a famous artist is going to just become diminished over time, because there's so many more people now that, you can get a laptop, you can download some kind of audio workstation onto your laptop, and you can make a podcast, or you can make music, or you can download Photoshop and you can make amazing art, which 40 years ago, 30 years ago, you definitely couldn't do that. It was a lot more exclusive. So it's so much more inclusive now, and there's so many more published artists that are being published from the bedrooms, and that's going to change. That is changing everything when it comes to media, it comes to music and art and being creative.
So what's your plans then? So you're doing the reviews at the moment, and
Yeah.
so what's your sort of 1 year, 2 year, sort of what you're aiming for?
So the music reviews, I want to start doing interviews. I want to start doing a lot more where there's a written review that corresponds to the podcast itself, so you can hear. Oh, I want to start filming them as well. I like your style, man. I think it's very cool. It's a bit of a Joe Rogan-esque thing go on in over there, and I want to get some of it. Where a podcast, it's a recorded podcast, you can download it, listen to it, but there's also it's the holistic thing. It's also the YouTube video goes with it, and you can read the review as well. So I just want to get a bit more in depth with what I'm doing, because I used to do all of this stuff with a view to it being very much based around success or fame. I think when I was brought up, I had this mindset of like, yeah, one day I'm going to be a famous this or a famous that. I don't know if other people have that, or if it was just my attention seeking nature, I don't know. But I had this thing where I was a kid, where I was, yeah, I'm going to be really successful, and that's gone as I've got into my 30s. I don't really care about that anymore. I feel I need to do that. And what it's been replaced with is this like hunger to like get really deep into what I'm doing and what I'm into, my passions in life. And talking about music and getting into these kind of conversations is definitely what I love to do the most. So just getting more in depth with it, really, over the next year, break each sort of podcast down into segments a lot more, and do a lot more sort of features on the show. So an interview and then some songs that I review, and
Are
different segments like that.
you a performer yourself?
I've done a lot of performance in my time. Yeah, I do kind of soul music. I sing and play guitar.
Okay, so like you're doing that at the moment or not?
I do bits of it. I do. It's not my main focus, because I focus on the podcast. But I do like I post like videos on Facebook, if I'm honest, and stuff like that. I don't like go and do any gigs anymore like I used to when I was younger, or record any music that I put out. But I do have a sort of a view to do that over the next year. But that's definitely more of like a hobby that I would be doing, as opposed to something that, yeah, I'm gonna go and chase this dream of being a musician, just because I do feel more passionate about talking about it to people and reviewing it and being a bit more of a music journalist.
Have you ever tried to approach like the bigger sort of music industry media outlets, like sort of TV or the magazines or something like that? Have you ever gone for some kind of role?
What, working for actually like a TV station or a radio station or something like
Yeah.
that? Not really. I kind of got into this doing a music review by accident, really. Like, it kind of one thing fell into the other. So I do like I love doing this now, and I like doing it the way that I do it, with my own. Like, I get to talk about the bands that I like, and I get to go and find bands and musicians and create episodes the way that I, so I might be in a mood of listening to just nothing but indie music, or I don't know, death metal, depends on my mood, I don't know, or just rap. So I can do a podcast just completely on all the best rappers in the UK or whatever. So I think if I worked, but so the short answer is no, I haven't. I think if I work, if I went and worked for say, you know, Vice or something, I got some kind of job doing that, which would be cool. I have thought that a few times, like I could go and do that. That'd be cool, interviewing somebody for one of these media companies. But I don't know if I'd enjoy it. I think it might kick the ass out of it, and I'd stop being as passionate about it because it would turn into a job.
Right, I see.
Sort of thing. So I think it's probably because I did a little stint at a community radio station.
Yeah.
For a while, and I had that mindset. I thought, well, I'll do this. I'll learn how to do the radio station thing.
Mm.
I'll you know fiddle with the knobs and all the rest of it, and then off the back of that, I'll step up and I'll see if I can get a job at a proper radio station.
Yeah.
And I didn't enjoy it. I didn't enjoy sort of the structure of the radio station, and I had to be there at a certain time and I had to do this, which sounds really lazy, but it, when it's music for me or anything creative, I want to just be able to do it when I want to do it.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I don't feel inspired to do it
Yeah.
as much, you know.
Yeah, totally.
That's just me.
That's the great thing about podcasts, is flexible, isn't it? When you're doing everything on your terms, like, you know.
And you can do it whatever you want to talk about as well.
Yeah, that's right. It's really nice, that, isn't it? If you've got to do a 2-minute segment and you're only allowed to say certain things and you're not allowed to be politically incorrect and you're not allowed to make, it's like, who needs that?
No, I'm not into none of that. Not into none of that.
Yeah.
But I do appreciate that there is a level of professionalism that comes with the sort of the higher levels of media, like radio stations and that. You know, they do have a wider broadcast at the minute, you know, a wider sort of reach at the minute.
Mm.
But it's like I say, I do see that being replaced by podcasts. So I'm sticking to my guns with my own little podcast, and I think it's going to take off.
What about reviewing stuff? Like, and sorry, I know you review music, but what about reviewing equipment, like music equipment, recording equipment, DJ, you know, things like that? Is there other avenues?
There is. There's this engine stuff. A good avenue to get into is for reviewing, which I've tried before, is reviewing software.
Right.
If you review software, you get free software. If you're into making music or anything and you want some free, decent software, then start writing reviews about software, because software companies, it doesn't cost them anything to send you their digital product, really, does it? If it's an email and it's just a link and it's there anyway, they're making money from you subscribing. But if they give it you for a review, potentially 10, 20, 100 people might subscribe from that one review.
Well, they'll pay you as well. It's not just free. Like, presumably.
Oh, yeah, you can get paid for it as well. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Because I'm just thinking that, you know, there's money in that. You know, that's the kind of industry where there is money in software. And so
There's money in words these days.
How do you mean?
There's definitely money in words. It's like you're saying, there's money in, people want opinions. There's money in opinions, necessarily.
Well, words, yeah, but when it's a product or service that's actually, like, you know, software presumably is big industry, isn't it? You know, if, I don't know what it's called, it's been years since I've done it, like Logic, or I don't know what the software is now. But,
yeah, like Keybase and Pro Tools and stuff like that.
That kind of thing. It's big business. And so it's worth them paying proper money in order to promote their products, isn't it? Like, that's... You know, that might be a good route to go down, because if you pick an industry and a market where there ain't much money to be had, you're never going to make much money from monetizing it. But, you know, if you go towards where the money is, that the crumbs that fall off of those kind of industries are bigger, you know.
Yeah, well, it's going back to the same thing. If you've got to do bits of everything, you've got to spin a few plates if you want to. So this is actually how I make my money. So I write you know, blogs and content for businesses, basically.
Oh, right.
But it's the same. It's like marketing, isn't it? It's just digital marketing, content marketing.
Do they pay you to write?
Well, so I get paid by... so I've got clients that sort of pay me to do their social media and write blogs for their website, or write engaging social media posts and blog posts and stuff like that. And it's the same. People want opinions. When people go into websites, what draws people in when people are engaged in something online, it's because the person that's talking about it seems passionate about it. There's an opinion attached to this thing that they're reading. That's why they're engaged, because this person's expressing their opinion. So opinions are valuable at the minute. It's something that I think, is the age that we're in. We're in this information age, and we want to know what everyone thinks about everything. But, and we go online and, you know, we read these reviews, and I definitely see it going that way a lot more.
But when you say you're getting paid for that, is that the... What, I don't understand. Are you reviewing stuff? I don't understand.
Well, no, so it depends on what they want me to do. So I'll either... Yeah, I get paid to write reviews as well. So I might get paid by a restaurant who wants a review writing about their restaurant, like a professional review writing about their restaurant.
I see.
Just so it can go on their website, or it can go in the newspaper, or they might want a press release writing. So it's just, it's content writing for either websites or physical.
And how are you getting those jobs? Is there some kind of like agency or website that you're getting the jobs through?
How I get that sort of work is, at the minute, it's word of mouth, if I'm totally honest. So I find the best way of doing it is to physically get out and have a walk around and sort of go to shops.
Right.
These types of places that need this type of work tend to be retail, in my experience.
I see.
You know, if you got to imagine, if you're a shop owner, you're busy all day long, you've got people coming in and out of the shop. Let's say you sell clothes, for example. You might not always have the time to sit down and write an interesting, engaging blog about a new pair of shoes that you just got in that are inspired by Chanel or whatever, that you want your customers to read to bring them in, because you're dealing with customers all day long that are buying stuff. So, but they still want more customers coming in. You know, they just don't have the time to manage these extra bits. And that's kind of where marketing can come in.
So you literally walk around and go into shops and network and hustle and offer.
Yeah. Another place is Facebook. If you go into just Facebook groups and just keep your eye open, you know, Facebook, like selling pages and local community groups. So like, you know, Bristol buy, sell, swap sort of thing or whatever.
Yeah.
People go on there saying, does anybody know anything about social media? Or they'll put up a job post, which you can do on Facebook now. Mm. But yeah, but 9 times out of 10, I walk into town, and I walk, just if I'm out and about in town anyway, and if I walk past a little, they must think I'm so cheeky. And if I see walk past a little, you know, woman's boutique or whatever, and I just see this sort of woman in there who looks a little bit busy, I'll wait until the customers have come out, have a little walk in, got a business card, and just say, you know, do you use social media? And she says, well, you know, I've got an Instagram and don't really have much on it. If you need any help with anything, just there's my card.
Right.
And I leave it, and I'm not like kind of pushy or anything. I don't try and sell my services to companies. I literally just, if I feel that they might need it, I don't give it to anybody. I just hand in a card or draw up a conversation and just see where it goes.
Have you got a website with like your information on, like where you can send them and they can read about what you offer? Have you got it like that?
Yeah, so I've got the website, I've got Facebook, I've got Instagram.
Is that Twitter, a separate website to your music one?
It is, yeah. Do you want the... It's socialproofmedia.org.uk. It's quite a basic website at the minute. It's just like, you know, a little bit about me, a little bit about what the services are.
Yeah.
Content marketing and stuff like that. And then a bit of a contact submission form. And a video, just a little video on there of what I can do, like a little, it's like a little meme video, you know, where at the top and the bottom of the video, you can see like text that's kind of attention grabbing.
Yeah. I'm just, wait a second. What am I doing wrong? I'm typing it wrong. Socialproofmedia.org.uk.
Yeah.
Sorry, Craig.
No, it's all good.
What I'm doing wrong? It's not coming out. It's definitely live, is it?
Yeah, it's definitely live.
Okay.
Uh-oh, don't tell me my site's broken.
Might be. But check it after the call, don't worry.
All right.
Yeah. Oh, that's cool. So any other strings to your bow, then?
Any other strings to my bow? I know there's quite a few there, isn't there?
Yeah.
Well, just writing. I think all of the strings to my bow are all linked to being a writer, really. It's my main thing in life is just being a writer, a musician. But... writing, so I write a lot of poetry. I've, you know, published a couple of poetry books and stuff, but that's
really?
What's, yeah, well, it's just self-published stuff that you can put on Amazon. But there's one called Rebirth of Man, which is a bit of a, because I'm quite a spiritual guy as well, so that's another little string to my bow, I suppose. And that the Rebirth of Man poetry book that I wrote, that's a bit of a spiritual feel going on there.
So
That's on Amazon.
when you say self-published to Amazon, what do you mean? Do you have them physically printed?
No, so the digital downloads. So if you are a writer and you want to have something published, you can go, I forgot what it's called. I think it's Kindle. I think it's literally called Kindle Self-Publisher or something like that. Kindle Publisher. I can't remember what it's called now. But you just upload your PDF to the, you write your book or your poem or whatever, and then you upload your file to this website. I think it's called Kindle Publisher or something. And then what that does is it then puts it on Amazon for you, and it sells it on Amazon. And it's you can set the price of whatever you want the price to be. And if anybody's got a Kindle, they can read it on Kindle. And you can do the same with Apple as well. So if you've got an iPhone and you write something on your phone or whatever, and you've got the Pages app, which is the built-in Apple sort of text document app. If you write your poem or your book or whatever your manuscript, you can use another app called Connect, and that then literally connects your PDF or your EPUB file to Apple Books, and you can sell it on there as well. So all this is free as well, which is another amazing thing to think about, this sort of desktop publishing era that I think we're in. You can write something, just publish it, and there's no guarantee anyone's going to read it, but you publish it and it's potentially going out to millions of people if people download it.
I think it's very healthy to have creative self-expression as well. Like if there's stuff, it's kind of therapeutic really, isn't it? Like writing and expressing and, like for example with your poetry, just the process of getting it out of your head or out of
Definitely.
your heart or and onto paper and out there. That's a very healthy process to do. Like regardless of how many people buy it or it's kind of irrelevant in a way. Like if they do, that's a
It's very
bonus, but
cathartic. It gives you a great sense of catharsis. It's
I mean,
brilliant for catharsis.
in therapy, it's the same as journaling, I think. You're getting stuff out of your head, and by expressing it and putting it down on paper, it helps you make sense of your own thoughts and feelings, I think.
Definitely, yeah. Well, it's about consciousness as well. The poem that I wrote, it was like an epic poetic story, and it was. And so William Blake wrote something called The Marriage of Heaven and Hell, and it's kind of inspired by that. I didn't plagiarize any of it, but it's the kind of the feel of the theme of that book is what I wanted to write something like. So it's like a story of a guy called Solomon, and he's locked in his own mind. Something happens to him, he finds out somebody very close to him dies, and he kind of gets trapped in this coma of consciousness in his own mind and gets lost in there, and then he's battling his own ego in there, and then it's a really weird sort of epic poetic story that I wanted to get out. So yeah, it was like you say, it was like a just a form of expression that I needed to kind of get out. But what you're doing now, this podcast, and that's art to me. Anybody, even if you're a bricklayer and you're working really hard to have a new kitchen built in your house, that's your form of art. Everyone's at it. Everyone's creating constantly all the time.
I think it's really important. If there's stuff in you that you like want to get out and express, I think it's so important. Like you say, whatever avenue it comes out in, whether
Even
it's
just going to the gym, whatever, raising your kids, that's an artistic expression.
this the you can always tell somebody who's unexpressed, they just feel like they're clogged up and frustrated and they're just not
Locked a
happy.
little bit. Yeah, exactly.
You can just feel it, can't you? And then someone who's kind of living their life on their terms and they're sort of doing their best and they're giving it everything they got, even if they're not succeeding, they're kind of in the flow. There's sort of an aliveness in them, isn't there? You
Yeah, they
can
radiate,
sense.
don't they?
So yeah, it's weird. Some of us sort of go for it, but a lot of people don't, do they?
Well, I just think there's a lot of limiting beliefs in society. There's a lot of stuff that puts, but I mean, I'm not going to sit here and sort of say that I'm any sort of expert at, the successes of life or whatever. Everybody has limiting beliefs. There's things that I probably dreamt of doing when I was a kid that oh God, I wouldn't, I've never achieved it because at some point in my life I believed that I couldn't, or I've put myself down at some way. And I think we all do that.
Yeah.
I think it's, unfortunately, it's built into society a little bit to
Re
just work, get to work, get your head down.
Recently, I changed my lifestyle quite a bit, and I've sort of put much more focus on surrounding myself with people that are more successful, and it's, it's that thing, you become who you surround yourself with,
Course, like attracts like, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. And yeah, like I got to a point last year where I wasn't really happy with the people that was in my life. They were kind of nice in some ways, but they're just, in other ways, they just weren't compatible with me really, and it was sort of holding me back. So I kind of, got rid of a lot of that, and filled the vacuum with sort of better quality people, just to speak plainly.
You've got to though. You've got to because it's not a dress rehearsal, this.
Yeah.
And even if you believe in reincarnation or just monotheism or whatever, you're never going to be that this person ever again. You're never going to be this character ever again. And who you mix with and what you have in your life is very important. And it's not cruel. And you've got to do it without guilt. If you get rid of people that aren't not helping you, not like it's like using people, but if they're not in on your sort of frequency. That's how I try to think of it.
Yeah.
They're not on my level of vibration, so I'm trying to resonate at a certain frequency, and this person's like just bringing the mood down all the time, or there's just something up with them all the time. There's some beef or some drama or whatever, and I don't want to associate with it.
Yeah, you
And if
got,
it
and
keeps coming up, I want to filter it out.
you got to draw the line. You got to have boundaries, haven't you? Because in some ways, like some of the spirit, like the spiritual bypassing stuff, where
Yeah.
some people are so love and light that they've just got no boundaries, and they try and accept everything, and they end up just putting up with just
All
bullshit. And
sorts.
like, there's a point where you just got to say, "Nah, I ain't. I'm not okay with that. I'm not having that in my life. That's fucking bullshit. I don't give a fuck what you."
Well, you need to have what I call a fuck it button.
Yeah.
So I did an NLP course quite a few years ago. And we were getting into this idea of, filtering stuff out and what you sort of allow in to your subconscious. You need like a watchman at the gate of your subconscious. That's how I've been it's been described to me before. You need a watchman at the gate of your subconscious. So that is like a filter that does or doesn't let stuff in. And if it's something that's coming from somebody like an energy or just a mindset and attitude that isn't healthy, that's coming from somebody all the time, you need to push the fuck it button and say, get to fuck. Even if it's somebody that's the closest to you in your life, if their behavior, because that's all it is, it's just behavior, isn't them as a person. If their behavior isn't healthy for your mindset and is bringing you down and making you unhealthy, it's making you feel unhealthy in some way, you need to stop interacting with them, even if it's like your mum or your best mate. I can't be around somebody. If I'll help that person and try and help them or whatever, but if that person's just constantly bringing me down until they sort their heads out, I need to just sort of say, look, I'm just going to leave you to it for a bit because you're bringing me down. I've got shit to do. Sounds really selfish, but this is
Got
my
to,
life and you've
yeah.
got to do it,
You got to put your own oxygen mask on first, haven't you? You can't.
I always say that. I always say that. That's mad that you said that. You've got to put your own oxygen mask on first before you help other people, definitely.
And I heard another good phrase ages ago. You train people how to treat you. Like, you kind of set the standard and the expectation, and people will, like, if they know you and they know you're not going to put up with nonsense, they won't give you
They won't.
nonsense.
No, I found that. People kind of have. There's been like a conditioning of I don't get the bullshit now from people. I don't have to filter it out. It just doesn't come my way as
Yeah, it's
much.
weird how the world will reflect your expectations. Like, when you change what you're willing to put up with, the world will kind of reorganize itself to conform to that,
It manifests, doesn't it? It manifests around you.
Hey, listen,
We're getting
mate.
very esoteric now, aren't
Do you know what?
we?
I'm enjoying chatting, but I've got to get going.
No worries, no
So,
worries. It's been really cool talking to you, Ben. Honestly, thanks for calling me and letting me on your show. It's been really cool.
yeah, no worries. Keep us updated with anything you're doing, any events you're doing. Yeah,
I
let
will
us
do.
know
Yeah,
about
I'll
it.
send you the podcast when the shows come out.
Yeah,
I'll
do.
get you on it at some point.
Yeah,
Come on,
cool.
sing a song with us.
Yeah, all right then.
All
Nice.
right then.
All
Thanks for
right,
talking to
Craig.
me, man.
Thanks. Bye.
Cheers. Take care. Bye bye.